A warm welcome to everyone. And today we are in conversation with the illustrious Teesta Sethalwat, who is a renowned civil rights activist and journalist and Secretary of Citizens of Justice and Peace, CJP. She is also the granddaughter of India's first Attorney General, Shri M.C. Sethalwat, and her own father was a lawyer as well. Coming from a family of luminaries, who have stood for the Republic of India and the Constitution, Teesta herself is well known for her groundbreaking work in the aftermath of the 2002 Godhra riots, where she tirelessly worked for bringing justice to the victims and their families. Teesta testified at the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom on 10 June 2002 against the BJP-led Gujarat government's role in the post-Godhra communal violence. She is not a stranger to controversy, nor to being persecuted, as she was jailed too. Aside from her groundwork, she, with her husband Javed Anand, have done exemplary work in journalism, in advocating for minorities' rights and greater communal harmony through their publication, Communalism Combat and Sabrang India. She is seen even today leading from the front in many civic society initiatives and movements. Welcome, Teesta ji. It is an absolute honor to have you with us today.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So my first question to you today, from your decades-long career, from your decade-long career in mainstream journalism to your work against institutional bias from mid-80s to 1993. Your work has spanned over several decades, and you've been involved in very crucial movements and interventions through time, including the 2002 Godhra riots. Can you share some details about the work you've done, why you do the work you do, and what is your inspiration through it all?
Thank you so much, first of all, for having me on this program, Democratic Dialogues. It's a privilege to be here. A conversation of this kind is not always easy because people like us are so steeped somehow in the present, while always drawing on the experiences of the past, that we rarely have a time to really reflect on trajectories and nuances. But I think the very nature of one's work, the very nature of the kind of work I do and we do, compels us to actually calibrate and learn from the kind of situations and experiences of the past. So what we've actually been privy to in the work that I have done, we have done, fighting communalism, fighting the brute force of a majoritarian politics, being very, very clear when we started Communalism Combat in 1993 that while majority communalism is what threatens the Indian state and Indian society at a seminal level, minority communalism should not be ignored either. And minority communalism and majority communalism in one level, at one sense, at same sides of this, two sides of the same coin. All of these realizations came from both a theoretical and a practical understanding. From seeing my city of Mumbai get polarized and burn in 1992-93, being privy to very close friends anguished as they saw their city and the people of the capital, our Sikh community being ravaged in 1984. My having conversations with left and civil rights activists in Assam when Nelly happened in February 1983. And that's why Bombay 1992 93 was so seminal because it made us make the shift between, just commercial mainstream journalism to a kind of niche journalism. I won't call it activism, but it was niche journalism because when we launched Communalism Combat, we were proud that we would do it with a sense of professionalism, but that it would be explorative journalism. It would look at the causes for the buildup of conflict and the fallout, which mainstream journalism somehow doesn't allow you to do because the impatience with events and the headlines tends to run away with the news. And after a point, a story weans away its interest from the reader. Even if the reader is interested, the publishers decide that this is no more time for such a story. So the human elements of the fallout of conflict, violence, no more remain central to any public discourse or healing. And I think that's really a problem, because that doesn't help us get to the bottom of the problem. Doesn't let us as a society deal with what could possibly be solutions. And I think all of these combined realizations, both through the Bombay experience, which led me to actually delve into all the Judicial Commission reports of communal violence during partition, post-partition, and arrive at some sort of a deeper theoretical historiography of communal violence. You know, because I think when journalists and activists, particularly journalists, when they cover communal violence, have really no idea how this comes, where this comes from, what is the role of hate speech, and how we need to understand the role that hate speech plays in polarizing communities. So it's all of this and more that led you deeper and deeper into the nuances of the work that we do. And then, of course, when Gujarat happened, it took us straight into legal activism and civil rights work in the courts. During 92-93, it was more advocacy on the streets, battling for the Shri Krishna Commission, taking witnesses to the Shri Krishna Commission, making sure that their voices are heard, ensuring that the report is published. Because during the first NDA government, there were efforts to not allow that report to get published. All of that happened. But I think the legal experience of Gujarat was also seminal.
And so what is your inspiration, ma'am? Like, why do you do what you do?
I mean, that I think is a question which is most difficult to answer, because why do any of us do what we do? You know, I mean, why do any of us do what we do? There's obviously something that drives us in the work that we do. A belief maybe that which comes from how you've been brought up, with whom you've moved around with, how you grew up, with the values that you associate with in university, college, politically, that what are those values that are most important to really put your neck out there for. And I do believe one of the most important things to put our neck out there for is the much reviled term of secularism, because I think without secularism, this country doesn't exist. Without real, believed, lived secularism of state and society, the country as we know it, India as we know it, cannot be an entity, cannot survive. And secularism cannot and must not only be a kind of a gratis favor that the majority does to the minority. It also has to develop an understanding of caste hierarchies, anti-caste discrimination, because communalism has been preceded for thousands of years of caste discrimination in this country and society, which is something, again, that the privileged sections don't want to face. So our growth in communalism combat also had a lot to do with that, and understanding that you can't just be looking at communalism from the Hindu-Muslim point of view. There are other structures and deep fissures in society which you need to address. And if you really want to combat communalism, you have to really understand caste and what caste hierarchy and caste discrimination has meant to thousands of years of this country's existence and this people's existence. And yet, on the other hand, the hope that you derive from the people themselves, because long before you had the constitutional values articulated like the constitution, like Article 14, 15, 16, 19, 21, 25, 13, long before that, you actually had a lived expression of those values in the movements that this soil threw up. And whether it was Farivil and Lal Ded and, you know, in Kashmir, or whether it was Kabir, or whether it was 200 years before that, Tukaram and Namdev in the state I live in, which is Maharashtra, which is my home, or whether it was Soirabi and Chokamela, who are kind of poets from the Warkari tradition, who actually were not just questioning caste hierarchies, but also questioning the worship tradition that did not allow them inside the Vithoba temple. So there are lots and lots of nuances to this sense of equality and dignity and the struggle. And of course, Basavanataka, and of course, Narayan Guru, and of course, Sahu Maharaj. So I think we need to find some of these inspirations for ourselves. And I think there's enough inspiration from the people of India themselves and their lived experiences. Partition, I think, was a huge, huge blow to this nation's fabric, as we all know. I'm not saying something which is rocket science, but what I find really ununderstandable about partition, because it was such a huge human conflict, and it caused so much devastation and so much loss of life and so much cross-migration, forced migration of communities, that what Indians have failed to realize as Indians is that if you look at the map of India from Bihar to Bengal with Punjab in between, then actually partition impacted three communities equally brutally. And all three communities were equal perpetrators and equal victims and survivors. But somehow each of them has grown up with their own memories of themselves alone being the victim or the survivor. So that teaches you something. And all this one was felt compelled to go back to after 1992-93. When one started asking questions that how come a city like Mumbai, which is known for its cosmopolitan ethos, can suddenly erupt with suspicion and hatred in a manner in which one never expected. Is there something we are not dealing with? Are there some fissures which we should be actually talking about? What is this ghettoization phenomenon that happens after communal violence? Why do ultra-right forces actually insist on ghettoized communities? Because they do not like interaction regularly. The moment you allow communities and castes and gender to interact, then the stereotypes will not grow. The stereotypes will not fester. Because my experience of you and your experience of me will not allow that stereotype to stay. And therefore, the ghettoization is so necessary for that ideology, wherever it comes from. So all these realizations came through the kind of intense coverage of 92-93, delving into books, delving into commission reports, talking to people, talking to senior journalists, lawyers, mentors, who had actually experienced those periods before that.
Absolutely. And certainly, I do agree with you that, integration and inclusion and interaction between people is the biggest enemy of fascism. That brings me to the next question. You've fought an uphill battle for the victims of Godhra since 2002 with, instances of sabotage and a number of twists and turns over two decades. You were also jailed recently for a period of time. Yet you have come out of that and continue to fight with vigor. What is it about the state of our democracy that makes you do this? Are you not scared?
Let me talk a little bit about the struggle for justice for the survivors of Gujarat, for which we were certainly in the forefront. My organization, Citizens for Justice and Peace, and a band of lawyers and activists at the grassroots level in Gujarat. I just happened to be a face and the name that sort of was easy to pinpoint and even vilify. But there's a whole team and band of us out there. And I often ask myself, particularly today with the third term of this government and also the trajectory that this country has taken over the last 10 years, whether you could see that struggle as victory or defeat, and was the glass half empty or half full. And then I tell myself that, the fact is that we collectively did manage to get 174 convictions. 124 out of those were to life imprisonment in the first stage. Some of them, of course, got acquitted in the higher courts, which is inevitable and unfortunate in our country. But I think the lesson that the Gujarat struggle, justice struggle taught us, and maybe even taught the system, is that if there is an enabling environment for survivors and civil rights organizations to support them, which there isn't in this country, because in this country, whether it's the rape survivor or whether it's the Dalit survivor or whether it's the Muslim survivor, the moment you have a survivor stand up and an organization by his or her side, the first easiest target of the state and the perpetrators is to vilify first the supporting organization and then the survivor herself or himself. We've seen that happen. We've seen that happen with Gujarat, particularly because I again think it was the most visible and one relatively successful struggle, because not for 84, not for Nelly, not for Bombay 92-93 did we get these kind of convictions, And I do believe that if Nelly, there had been some accountability and justice, And let me put it out there that there was a Congress government at the center. We had army and police both called perpetrators. It was Bengali-speaking Muslims who were targeted. So I'm not talking about a particular party or a particular government, but one is talking about the creeping nature of majoritarianism that enters into institutional structures. And we saw that so bitterly in the capital of Delhi in 1984, for which, of course, Prime Minister Manmohan Singh and Sonia Gandhi have even publicly apologized. The scars remain, and I think the scars take a long, long time to heal. And justice is one way in which to heal them, because there's a semblance of, I don't know if justice can ever be substantive, because when your whole family has been wiped off, when a sister has been gang raped or a daughter has been, subject to gender violence, there's no such thing as substantive justice. But I think justice is needed to make the state accountable and transparent, and to make the perpetrators understand unequivocally that they cannot repeat this kind of act. And it's not out of a sense of revenge, but a sense of accountability. And it is from this spirit that the survivors of Gujarat fought. Amazing number of eyewitnesses were women, are women, and they showed amazing courage, whether it was Sardarpura or Naroda Patia or Gulbarg Society or Oud, any of these mass carnage cases. And, what people don't really know is that my organization also supported the Godhra families who had been of the S6 coach in Godhra. Five of the families had asked us to help them petition the Supreme Court for a transfer of that case outside Gujarat, which did not happen. So there's never been a religious lens in the work that we do. We look at wherever there is a sense of majoritarianism, where there's a sense of injustice, and we try and step in. Whether we like it or not, India has seen this brand of majoritarian, politicized, militarized Hinduism, which has actually taken a toll on this country and the country's culture and this country's sense, social fabric. And therefore, we have not just stood by it, but we've also been vilified for it. Fear is something that you can't say you never feel fear. I think all of us are human and we feel fear. But one way I found myself coping with it is to actually collectivize this fear into some social action. Fortunately, not allow yourself to get paralyzed by it, but to actually get galvanized by it into some collective discussion, dialogue, and action. I don't think anybody can say ever that you don't feel fear. But I think there's a way of dealing with it, which is that you find compatriots, you find other colleagues who are also feeling the heat the same way, feel the passion the same way, have some sense of direction, and also some sense of strategy. I think strategy is equally important when we are fighting these battles. Which battles do we take up when? And I think all of that makes for tempered conversations, and I think those are important. And one has benefited hugely from a vast array of compatriots, friends, colleagues who not only respect what we do and I do, but who also know that I respect them tremendously and love them deeply. So it's a mutual thing, you know. And it's only on that mutual basis that such intense activism-based relationships can work, you know. When you know that there is completely question faith in each other's integrity.
Absolutely. This brings me to the next question, ma'am. With the experience you have over so many decades, how do you view the mandate of this general election in 2024? Is it a Pyrrhic victory for BJP? Is it a win for the people of India? And is the mandate a reflection of the people's will?
You know, I think in the last 8 to 10 days since we've had the mandate, maybe 7 days, it's now 11th, so we had the mandate on the 4th. So I think if you had asked me this question on three different occasions, I'd probably have given you three different answers. So it's a difficult one. It's a very difficult one, largely because of the sheer intensity with which one has been involved in part of a wider collective movement to ensure that democratic spaces get widened, to ensure that there is accountability from the political process, that every vote is allowed to count, that those discriminated sections often are left out of the counting process for a variety of societal and political reasons, must and do cast their vote. So for all of these reasons, there's been an intense involvement inspired, I must say, by Karnataka, which last year actually managed a unique experiment in this kind of citizens' engagement. So I think, I mean, if you look at the numbers, minus all these nuances, it's still single largest party, BJP, obvious party that needs to form the government or must form the government, has its partners in the NDA, from Nitish Kumar and Chandrababu Naidu. So where's the problem? Why should there even be a question? But I think we need to be a little bit more incisive and nuanced than that. Just look at what was happening in this country for the last 2 months, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. And I think, you know, system should also look at it. Analysts should also look at it with a little bit of humility, you know, because it's so easy otherwise to look at it in a black and white way. And I think we need to just ask ourselves, was it a level playing field? Was it a really, and I'm not talking about just the election commission behavior, which was deplorable in my mind, right through this whole election, and even for a while before that. But it's not just that, it's the manner in which this government was functioning for the last 5 years, 7 years, 10 years. It began with the repression of students in 2016. Completely violent suppression of the peaceful agitation in the Hyderabad Central University, the institutional murder of Rohit Vemula, then the attacks on students of JNU, Jawaharlal Nehru campus, the vilification. Along with the violence was the violent vilification of JNU as an institution, you know. In fact, I often tell myself that if one sits back for an interview like this, how will I ever be able to complete what I have to say, because the sheer calendar of horrors that we have gone through in the last 10 years, both human and institutional, will just take about an hour to recount. You know, it's just so many of them. And the only way I can sum it up, only way I can sum it up is when I summed it up in a PUCL lecture I gave, the Kannabiran lecture I gave in Madurai in 2016, when I said this government has declared a war on all sections of its people. So whether it's Adivasis, whether it's workers, whether it's minorities, whether it's women, students, middle class, working class, everybody, you know, because it is not a government of the people, for the people and by the people. But yet it has got this aphrodisiac of propaganda, majoritarianism, aphrodisiac of hate, which has actually propelled a large section of our fellow Indians into believing that it's the best government for us. And that is why it's such a challenge for people like us who have to battle this at so many levels, battle the level of propaganda. So, cutting all this short, I think that just imagine in March of 2024, it never even seemed that there would be a fight when you had one more chief minister getting arrested in April after Hemant Soren, you had Arvind Kejriwal, Congress Party's accounts being frozen. Even before that, the manner in which the articulation of the opposition leaders who had formed themselves into the India Alliance somehow did not seem convincing enough. You know, it did not seem as if it had gelled together as an alliance. Will it be able to inspire people into believing it was an alternative? That was a question in our minds. So, of course, for some of us, any alternative would have been preferable to the possibility of a BJP back in power. And I go back to 77 for this, when we actually I was 16 and a half, and we actually campaigned against the Congress Party during the emergency, saying that, you know, this government has to be out. We didn't look at to see which was the government on the other side, that it's a Khichdi government or a Janta government. But you believe that this particular government has to be voted out. So similarly, there was that sentiment. But for a large section of our people, who may not have felt the same way, and I'm not trying to be superior to them, but for a variety of reasons, they did not believe that there was it was a convincing enough opposition to be able to rally around. Then I see what happened in April, and then I see what happened in May, and what happened all of April and May, and I feel that a really good fight was put up. A really good fight was put up. A fight that actually was pushed and pushed and pushed by a myriad citizens' movements and people's movements across the country. It was not centrally controlled. It was not one agency or anything. It was just actually, as the way it's been expressed by so many people, that it was Janta, Awam, and Sarkar. Janta or Awam, Sarkar ke saath. And I think this, I've actually experienced this when I was 16 after the emergency. So I know what it feels. And I felt it tangibly in my state of Maharashtra. I felt it very tangibly in some other states that I moved around in. That people are actually coming forward. I have had police officers, serving police officers tell me that even if the opposition puts up a statue, we don't know, we will still vote against the government. You know, so there was that sentiment because I think things had reached a pause. So having said both things between March and then what happened through the campaign, you're then faced with this result where BJP is back in the saddle, the ministries are what they are, the language of the number one doesn't suggest any sort of rethinking or remorse, if at all that was a part of his makeup. The only relieving moment was a statement by none less than the RSS chief, Mohan Bhagwat, yesterday, who was talked about, beautifully said in Hindi that, you know, you should be looking at, not be talking out of ahankar and arrogance, you should be talking out of respect for the opposition. They're not a vipaksh, but they're a pratipaksh. Now imagine these words of wisdom coming from the RSS to the sitting prime minister. So these are things which tell you things that are happening behind the scenes, but yet you have a government back in saddle, but what we also have is a very strong opposition. So let me sum it up by saying far from ideal. One was hoping it would be 20 seats less for the BJP, in which case it would have been 20 seats more and a more healthier chance of an India government. For sure, we were hoping that. But I think it'll also be one more test maybe for the opposition and for us, that the energy that was galvanized towards this campaign needs to be sustained while this party remains in power, and to ensure that it does not function in the same way as it did for 10 years. And it's not just the second term when it functioned like that. The endless line from the Aadhaar bill to the articles that bringing in bills like money bills so that they don't have to go to the Rajya Sabha, giving a go-by to parliamentary procedure, suspending over 150 MPs, all of this just showed a complete disrespect for democratic norms and parliamentary democracy and the constitution. And therefore, it's no wonder that the slogan that caught the imagination of our people this time was that the constitution is in danger. And that, I feel, is something we need to hang on to. That we will not let the constitution be trampled upon, because our existence depends on the survival of the constitution.
Absolutely. I think one of the most defining shifts that took place, Teesaji, I don't know if you will agree with this, is that for the first time in a decade, it was the opposition that was setting the narrative, and the BJP every and moment, Modi were responding to it.
Every moment. And in fact, even the desperation with which the filthy hate speech was being rendered by the Prime Minister, right from Banswara on the 22nd of April onwards, was also a sign of ultimate and shameful desperation, you know, because he seemed to think that the old tactic will work again. And yes, again, the answer was that it did not work. It did not work in Uttar Pradesh. It did not work in Bihar. It did not work in the Hindi heartland. In fact, even in my state of Maharashtra, the maximum places that he visited and delivered such speeches, those seats have been lost by the BJP.
And the same happened in Goa also, ma'am. I'll share that Modi came to Kortali in South Goa district, and South Goa has come to Congress. So that was a very big, good thing that came out of this election. Now let's move on to the
So in
next
one sense, I
question.
would say, there's been a rejection of his sense of invincibility and his overpowering presence in our politics.
Oh, absolutely. Without a doubt. I think Faizabad is a very big example of that, and so many
Beautiful,
other places.
beautiful. And for you who's much younger than me, I'll tell you, in 1991, on the eve of the demolition, also, CPI had won the seat from Faizabad. So there's a
Oh, okay.
long
Wow.
tradition of this. There's a long tradition of this.
Okay.
People should not, people have to understand our people that yes, there has been moments, and there have been moments in 10 years when people have been swayed by this majoritarian identity politics. But I think when there's a strong alternate politics based on social justice, that can be a very, very strong counter. But it has to be meaningful. It should not just be tokenism. You know, that's the thing. It should not be just about names and associations. It has to do with real gelling between the sections that are victims of absence of social justice.
Absolutely. Now, the next question, ma'am. Though the constitution is now safe from being changed or canned altogether, which many leaders from the BJP had very openly expressed that they needed 400 par to change the constitution, will the attack on constitutional values end with the current mandate? Do you think activists like yourself and many others who are still languishing in jail or carrying out their work outside get a reprieve from harassment or persecution?
It's far too early to say. It's far too early to say, and I think it's best not to predict something which is so difficult to assess because, with the ideology in place, a majoritarian ideology in place, a kind of extremely vicarious, militarized number one and number two who are completely obsessed with their single-minded goals of retaining power, we don't know. But I think what will happen is, and I hope that does happen, is that the sense of paralysis and silence in the political opposition will go, that they should be speaking up. They should be speaking up for these civil liberties issues. In fact, my organization, Citizen for Justice and Peace, along with PUCL Maharashtra, has brought out a human rights manifesto for 2024. And we are going to start campaigning on it.
Okay.
We brought this out before the elections, of course. And one of the major demands is an ask of repealing as many as 31 laws and amendments to 31 laws, which have deliberately weaponized both the criminal justice system, environment laws, cow slaughter laws, and many such. So it's a long uphill battle to repair the damage of the last decade. You know, it's not going to be easy. Like I try to tell everybody that until 2014, were we a perfect democracy? Certainly not. But we were a democracy in the making. There were spaces, rights legislations were being passed. After many, many decades of independence, voices of the Adivasis, the minorities, Dalits were actually being heard in parliament after many, many decades of struggle. This 10 years was a regression, complete regression. So we just need to claw
Absolutely.
our way back. We need to claw our way back, hang in there, ensure that the Digital Protection Bill, independent media, the press registration bill, all these efforts by this government to stifle expression and free media, all of these things, the CAA 2019, all of these are repealed and kept in abeyance. How much we'll succeed, I don't know. But I think the main thing that's happened is the sense of fear has gone. The sense of fear and invincibility among people seems to have dissipated. And we need to hold on to
Yes.
this confidence. We need to hold on to this confidence that the streets are ours. The country is ours, public spaces are ours, and the Constitution is ours to protect. And our values are ours to protect. We should not be just sitting in our rooms and homes, trembling with fear as what is happening. If something goes wrong, we should have the confidence to come out and demonstrate, to speak, and whether it's a Shaheen Bagh, whether it's the farmers' protest, the government should not have the right and the guts to vilify these protests with filthy words. And actually, huge sacrifices that these movements have made. We need to remember the last 10 years and what the 750 farmers losing their lives. How many Muslims have been not just lynched to death, how many Dalits have been lynched to death, but how the Muslim community must have been living completely invisibilized and slurred and stigmatized is something I think all Indians will have to start thinking about. Christians too, including in Chhattisgarh, which was earlier ruled by a Congress government. So I think there are lots of issues which are under the thing which we need to address one by one. And if there are two regrets I have about this electoral campaign, which otherwise was so liberating when you heard talks of jobs and social justice and Forest Rights Act and Adivasis and, you know, I mean, to hear a national leader like Rahul Gandhi speak about remuneration for domestic work for women is something that feminists have dreamed of, right? So it's a very lovely thing to hear in the public sphere. It was wonderful. But what I really, really missed was the articulation of the injustice done to Muslims. So the invisibilization of the Muslim community, both in terms of articulation and in terms of the seat representation, was very, very sad. And equally well, the invisibilization of the crimes against women. If you remember Hathras, if you remember Unnao, if you remember what our wrestlers went through, our students in the Banaras Hindu University, in the wretched constituency of the Prime Minister, you've had the worst kind of sexual offences, and there's a complete silence from him. How can we forget Manipur? Manipur, which was simmering right up to today, and what happened to our sisters and mothers there and our daughters there. It doesn't, it's not a matter of concern for this regime. And the Prajwal Ravanna case, which of course Karnataka answered back by ensuring that he was not voted back. But the fear and the indignity that it perpetrated among the women of Hassan, Karnataka and India is not something that was openly talked about in the campaign by many leaders. Though, of course, Alka Lamba and others kept referring to it in their press conferences. So those are some of the regrets one has when one wants a campaign to open up even more. But I think it was a huge, huge sense of liberation and relief to hear the India opposition set the agenda, which was a constructive agenda, it was a positive agenda, and it was not negative and filled with hate.
And extremely progressive to in its nature.
Yeah.
So before we end, I have one more question to you, and it's a lighter question now. So if you were given the chance and to see it fulfilled, what would be the India you would like to see?
I'd like to see an India where there are lots and lots of women in parliament. Lots of women in parliament, in the panchayat, in the Vidhan Sabha. And I'd like to see an India where any sort of sectarian ideology has been reduced completely, if not completely nullified, because one believes in democracy. So I guess it can never completely go away, but at least reduced to a not non-dangerous form. And I think an India where I think sports and dance and music and art is also taught across, you know, across the spectrum, where we have a common school system. So where the children of, you know, our children who are more privileged study along with children who are not so privileged, so that we actually open up much more talent pools in this country, which we've not given millions of our children so far. And a country which really, really enjoys and respects its food and farmers who grow that food. And I think also we need to respect our environment. It's frightening when we think of water. My city, Mumbai, 27,000 trees have been cut in the last 5 years. We are looking at a water crisis of huge dimensions. And forget communal, we might be looking at water riots by in the next 5 or 6 years because things are so bad. So are we concerned about preserving the environment, not having this rapacious construction as we have in Mumbai, Delhi, I believe even Bangalore, Goa has been ruined by that construction as well. So I think a lot of these things need, what kind of development do we want? Do we want a development which looks at, you know, cement and mortar and steel and air conditioner, or do we look at a development which actually looks at nature, human values, preserving the Western Ghats, Himalayas, etc.? Look at the Ladakh protest that we were so inspired by in April, and which actually won the people of Ladakh an opposition member of parliament. And I think these are little openings that we have seen. Amazingly brave, the way he, I mean, I didn't believe he was 25 days out in the cold on a hunger fast like that. I mean, who would have thought that it's possible? but it happened, and we all saw it, and we were witness to that amazing bravery. So I think these are our heroes, and we need to build upon their movements and echo their movements.
Absolutely. So I huge thank you to you, ma'am Teesta Sethalwad, for joining us today and sharing your thoughts in so much detail. And I concur with you when you mentioned that a lot of what happens in the mainstream media, there's not enough time, because it's the news cycle and headlines coming and going. There's not enough time to explore subjects or experiences of people deeply. So I really salute you and thank you for doing this with us and spending the time and going into detail about what your experience has been and what your vision. I'm extremely happy to see your vision about India, because I also think very much along the same lines, and I'm sure so many do. So really, thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much for having me. Thanks so much.
And to all the viewers who would have watched this segment today, I urge you to please like, comment, share, and please subscribe to the channel. These are conversations which you would not find otherwise in the mainstream media. So it's important that it reaches people. And this is also a medium and an instrument for all of us to gather and gain that companionship and sharing perspectives with each other going forward in the struggle that's coming also in our way. So thank you once again, and stay tuned. We will be back with another segment quite soon. Thank you so much.
ಮತ್ತಷ್ಟು ವಿಶೇಷ ವಿಡಿಯೋಗಳನ್ನು ನೋಡಲು ಮತ್ತು ಹೊಸ ವಿಡಿಯೋಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ತಿಳಿಯಲು ಈ ದಿನ .com ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಚಾನೆಲ್ ಸಬ್ಸ್ಕ್ರೈಬ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಮತ್ತು ಬೆಲ್ ಐಕಾನ್ ಕ್ಲಿಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ.